Okay, welcome everybody. I'm Tommaso Bantino from Politecnico di Milano in Milan, Italy. Thank you for the kind invitation. I'm going to try to tell you today how things work in Europe regarding the design of FRP-reinforced concrete structures. So, the question is, can you use composite reinforcing bars in Europe and how you can use them? The current situation is that in Europe, each country can provide specific acceptance criteria for composite bars and specific design rules for construction materials. Recently, when we are talking about composite bars, a European assessment document, an EAD, which is basically a collection of acceptance criteria, were provided for composite bars, and namely bars made with carbon, glass, basalt, and aramid fibers. According to this document, a manufacturer, a producer, can obtain the CE marking, which is the, let's say, basic level to be able to sell the product and use the product in Europe. In addition to this, each country can provide the national acceptance criteria, so it is not mandatory, depending on the country. For example, in Italy we have acceptance criteria called linea guida. In France there is a recently issued document that contains indication on how to characterize mechanical test your composite bar in order to be able to sell your product, and there are other countries with specific acceptance criteria. Regarding the design, also in this case, as I said, each country can provide its own design guidelines. We have some of them. For example, in Italy we have an old document, the CNRDT 203 of 2006, currently under review. There is a European FIB bulletin, the Bulletin 40 of 2007, that is currently under review as well. There is a recently released in 2023 French design guideline. And in last December, the new version of the Eurocode 2 was issued, and it contains the Annex R, which is an informative annex that provides indication on how to design with composite bars. In this case, the word informative is really important because it means that whereas the Eurocode 2 is mandatory, which means that each country in Europe must follow the provisions of the Eurocode, in the case of the informative annex, it is not mandatory. So each country can decide whether to accept the indication provided or to provide a national design guideline that substitutes those indications. Today I decided to focus the European picture, so I'm going to show you, actually I'm going to introduce you to the EAD, so the acceptance criteria to obtain the CE marking, and since this is a novelty, to the Annex R, the informative annex of the Eurocode 2. So first, EAD, how can you obtain a CE marking? As I told you, the EAD stands for a European Assessment Document. It's basically a collection of tests that allow you to obtain the essential characteristic and relevant according to the relevant assessment methods and criteria provided by the document. Once you did all the tests, not all the tests, but some of the tests, you can decide what test you want to do included in the EAD. After doing the test, you can obtain the European Technical Approval, the ETA. Once you have the ETA, if you follow the assessment and verification of constancy of performance, you have a declaration of performance, that is a document containing the basic features of your product, and you can obtain the CE marking. Okay, these two things, the ETA and the CE marking, are two completely, not completely, but are two different things. You need the AVCP to obtain the CE marking. The fact that you have the ETA does not mean that you have the CE marking. Once you have the marking, you can use your composite bar all over the 27 countries in Europe, okay? However, although this document was drafted a few years ago, it is still pending for citation in the European organization. That which means that there is no CE marking available yet in Europe regarding the combat device. We are still waiting for the citation, for the publication of the document. For this reason, today I'm going to show you just a few examples of the test included in that EAD. As a comparison, in Italy, for example, if you decide, I don't want to do the path for the CE marking, I want to sell my product only in a specific country, then I follow the national guidelines. This is just an example in Italy. The Italian acceptance criteria are called linea guida. If you follow the specification of this LG, you can obtain a CVT, and according to this CVT, you can sell your product only in that specific country. So in this case, only in Italy, not in the rest of Europe. That's the main difference. Okay, regarding the EAD, these are the tests provided by the EAD. As I told you already, it is not mandatory to do all the tests. A manufacturer can decide what property he is interested in. I'm going to show you just the most important cross-sectional properties. All these indications usually refer to other standards or a provision from European or international standards. In this case, it refers to NASTM and it uses the immersion method. Tensile properties, compressive properties, bond and transverse shear strength refer to the ISO, which is an European standard, 10406. There you can see an example of a tensile test and a compressive test according to that standard. Interlaminar shear strength, in this case, although it is an European acceptance criteria, it refers to the US ASTM. We have specification for tensile fatigue. In this case, it's not that easy to obtain the characteristics provided by the EAD, because in that case it requires the construction of the entire SN curve, which is really expensive and takes forever. In that case, that's a collection of results taken from the literature. We carried out a lot of tests, but for a specific range of load. And then there is a bunch of archery resistant tests, so basically tensile test, interlaminar shear test, transverse test, after exposure of this specimen to an alkaline environment. Regarding the Eurocode, also in this case, I'm going to show you just the most important portions. I'm not going into details. If you're interested, you can try to ask me, because it's not granted that I remember details of each specific section. What I believe is important are the partial factor for FRP reinforcement. Also in this case, these are only suggested partial factors. The Eurocode 2 says that national guidelines and code can replace these suggested factors based on the specific national annex to the building code. In this case, you can see that we have a partial factor of 1.5 for composite bars, for the ultimate limit state. Regarding the material, Eurocode 2 provides minimum level of the mechanical properties. As you can see here, the elastic modulus must be higher or equal than 40 gigapascal, and also the tensile strength must be higher than 70% of this FTK, which is the characteristic value of the tensile strength of the bar at time zero. That the FFTD, that's the tensile strength used for design, that's the design value, is the ratio between that partial safety factor and the characteristic value of the tensile strength at 100 years. In that case, as you can see from that formula, you are considering a tensile strength of the rebar which is much lower than the actual, so the mean tensile strength according to those reduction factors. We can go into details if you are interested in that. And then, very quickly, Eurocode 2 provides indication for bending, shear in case of FRP shear, internal shear strengthening or not. indication for bond, so the anchorage length and bonded length, which is basically the same formula we have for steel with different coefficients. And then just as a summary, here you can see what we currently have in Italy. What I think is important is to focus on the fact that we have European acceptance criteria according to EAD, even though it's still pending citation, so you cannot find the document, and we have the newly released European Eurocode 2 that provide design equations to design reinforced concrete membrane.